Assalamu alaikum students, hope you all will be fine. And today we are going to study or read the Mughal Dynasty 2 from page number 102 to 107. Like yesterday, in last lecture I gave you the introduction of the Jahangir. Like Jahangir was the son of Akbar, and Jahangir means conqueror of the world, and he was a highly educated man, and he had a good command on Arabic, Hindi and Persian, and he had great interest in painting, fine arts, music, architecture. So he also had interest in Mughal, in gold, jewels and coins. And as we all know, Mughals were famous for their love of precious metals and stones. And Jahangir possessed 38 kg of diamonds, 504 kg of rubies and 126 kgs of emerald. These were the jewels and the gold things he was having at that time, and he also introduced special coins. He designed a set of unique coins which showed signs of the zodiac. These zodiac coins were very popular collector's item during Jahangir's reign and were worth 20 times more than their face value. Zodiac coins are the coins which are having pictures of different animals, and like bull, elephant, lion, and if you are interested in horoscope, those are your zodiac sign according to your birth date. Those signs are called zodiac signs. The coins showed images of animal symbols, the coins showed images of animals and were considered un-Islamic. Shah Jahan later took them out of the circulation and melted them down. It is un-Islamic to have pictures on coins of animals and different images. So when Shah Jahan came to throne and he stopped the circulation and melted down all those coins of Jahangir, or Jahangir also ordered some huge coins to be made on one occasion, and that was the birthday of a Persian ambassador, and he presented those coins to the Persian ambassador. Jahangir gave him 4 gold coins weighing 400 tolas, 300 tolas, 200 tolas and 100 tolas. And he also made a pure gold coin which still exists. We can have this coin these days also, the biggest and the most expensive in the world. And its measurement is 20 centimeter in diameter. And it contains 383.75 troy ounces, or almost 12 kilogram of gold. It's so heavy, and it's so big, and it this coin still exists in the world. And as I told you earlier, like Jahangir's love of beauty of nature, like he was much interested in building gardens. And less interested in building and built gardens with elegant marble and pavilions, and also paintings. He loved to do paintings and were perhaps Jahangir's greatest love. And the flowers and the gardens and all this stuff, he was too much in it for his love in painting, making gardens, flowers, animals, and all these things. If I talk about Jahangir and religion and about his justice, Jahangir continued the policy of religious toleration that had existed in Akbar's time, and he allowed Hindu festivals to be celebrated and continued the religious debates by scholars and clerics. He was much in Hinduism, and he also used to wore turban and red mark on his forehead, and built temples and all this. And about, if we talk about his justice, and he appointed the best judges of his empire, and he made it known to his people that if anyone needed justice, they could approach him directly. And when he came to the throne, he ordered the hanging of a series of bells in his palace called the Chain of Justice. Now, this William Hawkins personally saw the Chain of Justice. It was made of pure gold. It was 25 meters in length and had 60 bells. Its weight was about 100 kg. Now, I'm going to tell you about the sea captains at the Mughal court. The first one was William Hawkins, and he visited the court of Jahangir in 1607 in Agra with a letter from James I. James I, king, he was a king, and he sent William Hawkins for the trade purposes over there and making the trade agreements by Mughal. At that time, as I told you, like indigo blue dye and the goods made of cotton were traded over there, and now they were replaced with the spices, the most important trade goods to Europe. Cotton was the most important trading item in India, and weaving was country's largest industry because of the cotton. At that time, the Portuguese had special privilege at court and did not like Hawkins' arrival. But Hawkins, like Jahangir, could speak Turkish and became a favorite with the emperor. He was the favorite of Jahangir, and Jahangir also started giving him salary, and he also gave him a title of Khan and troops to command. After 3 years, Jahangir got tired of Hawkins and sent him back. And Hawkins died on the voyage home to England. But his wife arrived safely and tried to claim a pension from the East India Company. And she was given that. And the next one, Sir Thomas Rowe, we will talk about. That was ambassador to India. And he came in 1615. He came on a ship line, arrived at Surat with three other ships. When they reached Surat, the ship fired a 48-gun salute to announce the ambassador's arrival. When Sir Thomas Rowe arrived over there on his ship line, the 48 guns saluted him, and they planned a ceremony for him to welcome him as he stepped on the Indian soil. But music was played by the ship band, and Indian officers was waiting to meet Sir Thomas Rowe. But Thomas explained that he had come to bring friendship and peace. But the Indian officer said that first, Sir Thomas must be searched. Sir Thomas felt insulted, like he was expecting something else, and he came to know about like this. He was being searched at night on board, and he got back on board offline and refused to come ashore again until the Indian officer changed his mind. Like it was an insult to him. लाइक ही वॉज एक्सपेक्टिंग सो मच बट दे आस्क्ड हिम टू सर्च फर्स्ट एंड देन गेट आउट ओवर देयर. सो विलियम हॉकिंस और थॉमस रूथ और लाइक थॉमस Ro gave Jahangir many presents, including precious stones, dogs, horses, and saddles. The gift Jahangir often gave Sir Thomas gifts in return. What Jahangir gave him in return were the animals, fruits. Jahangir also gave Ro a miniature portrait to wear as a sign of great honor. And Jahangir was also interested in art and architecture. Jahangir became a patron of Mughal art, which reached a high level during his reign. He employed great painters like Ustad Mansur at his court and encouraged them to be in the European style. Jahangir and his wife Noorjahan mean light of the world, spent many summers in Kashmir, and so he sanctioned the creation of gardens in the area known as the Shalimar Bagh in 1619. The garden had three terraces with many fountains and trees. The lower terrace for public audience with the emperor, and the central terrace for private audience with emperor, the upper terrace for Noor Jahan, which also contained pavilion. Now I'll tell you about the Noor Jahan was allowed to order the building of a tomb for her father Itamaduddaula. Itamaduddaula was the father of Noor Jahan, who had been an important official at the Mughal court. It was completed in 1628. Previously, Mughal architecture had featured red sandstone, but this was an early example of the second phase of Mughal architecture, which used with white marble. It was being used the red marble in Mughal times, and this was the first time they were making with the white marble. Now, about Jahangir from page number 102 to 107. I hope you understand, and please do the given question on the screen and read it properly first, and then highlight and underline all the important points, and then do it your own notebooks. Thank you so much.